I'm going to present you the modern medicine and usage of Chinese characters in Japan. As an introduction, let me begin with a quiz. I think you're familiar with these letters, number one, and number two, and can you read and understand those meanings? And I think the answer is yes, for most college graduates these days. But let me ask you another way. Well, of course, number one is the cancer, gun, and number two is utsubyo for depression or depressive illness. But let me ask you another way. Now, can you write these letters by heart? And then answer is probably yes and no for most of the college graduates. Now, let me discuss about cancer. The letters gan and or kana gan. The Japanese government is now using kanas rather than the Chinese character in official documents. This rule started at Ministry of Health and Labor, also Rodero Show, and was followed by next Monkarasho. And this move helped familiarize the disease to the general public. It is easy to read and write in kanas, and everybody knows the word cancer, gan, and what it means. However, this can cause troubles in some occasions as below. Let's think about this English sentence. Mandibular cancer metastasized to the right jaw joint. It's a little bit technical in the medical field. If I write it in only with kanas, can you read it? Kagaku gangaku gasu kansetsu ni kenshu. It's almost incomprehensible. However, if I'm allowed to use Chinese characters, it's very easy to comprehend. So, we can keep this in mind. However, the question is whether we should use the Chinese characters all the time, or how much and how we can educate people. We'll discuss that later. Let's continue on the quiz. How about the letters from number 3 to 7? These are all medical terms. Can you read them, understand them, or can you even write these letters? Now, number 3 is nodule, means a cyst. And number 4 is tokotsu, it's a nasal of the bone, radius. 5, heikotsu, tibia. Hikotsu, fibula. And shikotsu, ethmoid bone. I'll show you what they are. The cysts, the famous for ovarian cysts, such as lanho nodule. In kanas, it's novel that the cysts are not infectious disease entities, such as shown here. This is a dissected cyst, a common disease in women. And here, if you say novel, because when the Chinese characters was introduced to Japan, it eliminated all these full tones of Chinese pronunciation. Quite often, I don't know in Chinese whether they are exactly identical pronunciation or not, but in Japanese they are both noble. Actually, they are so homonyms, do mi digo. And then noble, in this letter, can mean a completely different thing, an abscess. This is a skin abscess, so it's very complicated and confusing sometimes. How about large human bones? If you look at the lower legs, there are two bones called fibula and tibia. Hikotsu in Japanese and keikotsu in Japanese. And then hikotsu, the letter he means from the back side of the lower leg. And then keikotsu, k means the sune, the front side of the lower leg. And if you look at the upper arm, there are two bones in the forearm. It's called radius togotsu and ulna shankotsu. Now, shankotsu is very easy. The letter is very familiar. It's about 1 foot length. So that's the length of the woman. The togotsu is a complicated one. In the abstract, I said I don't know the meaning of this word. I checked it in the dictionaries and in the internet. But to, I learned that the to means a rudder. However, there's a very familiar letter in Japanese that says rudder for this book. So I don't know quotes in kana, it has the same pronunciation with topos or togai quotes. In that case, it means a skull or prey of the wind. How about shikotsu, which is the ethmoid form? Where is this ethmoid form? It's a complicated, it's a part of the cranium, it's forming the orbit, it's right here in the center of the vessel. Now, why do I focus on this such a minor bone? It's not a minor in fact. The letter shi means rui or sea, and it shows this appearance with many small holes or pores, and that's because of pores inside. And why this is so many pores, I don't know. Probably to make it lighter than the very solid form. But if you have a cold allergy, quite often these holes clog up, and that causes very, very painful pain, severe pain. So, and in fact, I have to confess that I have a cold allergy, and I'm taking drugs for 30 years. So this is a very important one for me. Anyway. So let's look at the historical aspects of the Chinese characters in Japanese medicine a little bit. This picture was drawn in the 16th century by this person, Chokeiga, in Japanese. And although this image of 16th century appears to be drawn based on the dissected human body, few changes were seen from the pictures of the Seoul era. So essentially, there were no changes for many centuries. And they, i.e., the doctors of the ancient China, viewed the body essentially through the visceral organs, those are roku, which means a liver, heart, spleen, lungs, kidneys, gallbladder, stomach, intestines, and blood, and so on. The zo, essentially mean solid organs, although heart is not solid. It's a big chamber inside, but it is composed of very thick muscles. So it looks like as if a solid organ. And the roku are essentially hollow structures such as stomach or, say, gallbladder or intestines and so on. Anyway, and then they view the body essentially through these viscera and the spinal column. That's why it looks like a little bit different from the real world. And why this is so inaccurate? This is likely because they seldom view the specific organs, such as the gut or spinal bones, as the direct target for therapy. In other words, in Chinese, classical Chinese medicine, people look at a more holistic approach than in Western medicine. That was the reason. Now, we heard Dr. Matsumoto mention about the Kaitai Shinsho. Historical aspects of European medicine is imported in the Edo area. This is the Kaitai Shinsho. And it means Atlas of Anatomy, published by Genkaku Sugita and Yotaku Maeda in around 1770. And this was actually a translation from a Dutch translation of originally German book, Anatomische Tabellen, means Atlas of Anatomy, written by Johann Kuhls. And although these people are doctors, but they're not necessarily the experts in Dutch language. And about 50 years later, Genkaku Tsuki, who read the Dutch and was very fluent in Dutch, corrected the minor errors in translations and then published the revised version. The book is consisted of four volumes of text and one volume of atlas. So essentially, it's a textbook of anatomy, but it's, as you can see in the cover, it says So summary of the medical terms, I mean, in this case, anatomical terms in Japan, Chinese characters have been used traditionally. Many of them are easy to comprehend and are already in our daily life. However, some of them are very difficult to read for lay people, not to mention writing them. New terms were invented using Chinese characters upon importation of Western medicine. There is a recent tendency to spell out terms phonetically with consonants rather than using Chinese characters. However, these practices often make them less comprehensible because of harmonies. With more English terms used internationally, it may be easier to use alphabetical words, directory, or some simple terms such as cis or radius. Now, the medicine is a very much a wider area of science, so we use a lot of natural science words. So let me extend it a little bit farther, some disciplines which are relevant to medicine. Let's look at the chemistry. You can see a very strong German influence, such as the English word for hydrogen, carbon, oxygen. These are all elements written in Japanese. We say suiso, hanso, sanso. But you will notice that these words are literal translation of German words Wasserstoff, Kohlenstoff, Sauerstoff. For example, another interesting example is the urea, which is a nitrogen compound excreted from the human body. Now, this is not an element, it's a compound, but simply because in German it's called Harnstoff. Our ancestors described it as Miosa. Now, some examples I can't understand where it is coming from. For Enzo, it's an element, but English is chlorine and German is chlor. However, there's another word called N, salt or salts in German, like table salt, which is sodium chloride, which contains the chlorine. Now, potassium chloride is also containing chlorine, and these are, say, salt, but salt, the definition of salt is the cation and an anion dissolved in the water will be, water will be evaporated and then they form ionic crystals. So sodium carbonate, it does not contain chlorine, but it's definitely one of the salts. And so the confusions are here and there sometimes. Now, let's move on to the biochemistry. Now, it studied in Germany before the World War II, and then more developments were seen in the United States or England, so we have a lot of words mixed up. For example, energy metabolism, we say Busch's Teilchen, that's literal translation of Stoffwechsel in Germany, in German. Glycolysis, glycolyse in German, we call Taketo. That's the Japanese way of translation using Chinese characters. But glucose is called glucose to the to the gas chamber. And this you say that has the same word as the you say here. So this has a lot of problem here. And I personally believe that we should rewrite the textbooks now. But anyway, we can discuss that later. Let's move on to the molecular biology and molecular genetics. Now, we see a lot of use of kind of astronomy. Many words such as transformation, transduction, oncogene, in my teacher's generation, shortly after the war, they worked hard to translate into Japanese, and they invented some words such as case dentum, case dodium. But nowadays, these words are rarely used and essentially spelled out, mimicking the original English words such as transformation, transduction, and so on. And then the more recent words such as clone or monoclonal, sometimes we say tan clone, sample monoclonal. Even weird is a natural killer cell called natural killer cell. Large T antigens is a large T colon, and here's an immunological term for the particular type of cells, immune cells. A professional antigen rejecting cell is called. But it's an odd name even for English. But the textbook says professional colon page site. I don't know the, I didn't have time to go into the dictionary, but maybe in Chinese it could probably read like this, saying your colon page site, probably. But the synapotosis, no Japanese translation. And the acronyms such as DNA and RNA are used as they are. In German, used to be written as DNS or RNS because these letters stand for desoxyribonucleinsäure or ribonucleinsäure. However, if you look at the modern textbooks in Germany, they're written in German, but these letters are mostly written in DNA and as DNA and RNA rather than DNS or RNS. Sometimes they put the parentheses and put these words. So sometimes it is easier to use Western alphabets directly or Chinese characters rather than mimic phonetically with kanas, especially for long terms. So summary for scientific terms in Japan. Before modern times, Chinese medical terms were introduced to Japan together with Chinese medicine. In the Edo period, Western medicine was introduced in the form of Dutch translation, mostly of German origin, which necessitated the creation of some new words in Chinese characters. In the 18th century, Western medicine and science were imported at a faster pace with coordinated efforts to translate their terms into Japanese using Chinese characters, which resulted in some mistakes, such as in genetics. During and after the World War II, efforts continued to create Japanese terms using Chinese characters, whereas more number of new terms necessitated the use of kanas to phonetically mimic Western words. To this end, German rather than English pronunciations were adopted. Contemporary medicine and science and technology as well is expanding with even faster speed with overwhelming numbers of new terms in English. This historical situation has caused inconsistency and confusion of mixing multiple origin words into a single technical term, such as glucose-6-phosphoisomerase, I said, as well as phonetic replacement of English terms with kanas, producing many lengthy terms that are often less comprehensible. While there is a recent tendency to use less Chinese characters, replacing them with kanas often causes confusion due to homonyms. Now, for technical terms, especially in professional communications, example in medicine, life sciences, chemistry, we should improve our current usage so that it will be simpler, clearer, and more consistent systematically. To this end, I'd like to propose the following. Number 1, try to use relatively simple Chinese characters in the correct context when they are available. Number 2, when do not exist, or only complicated ones are available, and or the original English words are much simpler, English terms should be adopted directly in the original alphabet spellings. Number three, minimize the use of commas to phonetically mimic technical terms and avoid abbreviations into the Japanese-style acronyms. I'll discuss that later. Through these practices, we can greatly help young professionals becoming more international, and they will be relieved from the double burdens of learning the same term in multiple languages. Now, I'd like to discuss this a bit further. It is interesting to consider this issue from more general perspectives. In Japan, there was a tendency to use Chinese characters during the World War II for imported words from the West. I hear that the Japanese government banned using Western words simply because they are the languages of the enemies. So, old terms in baseball were converted to Chinese characters such as Yakyu, Sanrida, Honrida, Shik, and so on, office for baseball, three base hit, home run, dead ball, and so on, respectively. Now, these days, however, many Western words are just phonetically replaced with commas, katakanas. Because many words are long, if spelled out in commas, such words are often abbreviated with only a few letters. This is causing further confusions and troubles in the Japanese language. Instead of saying "yoyaku" for appointment, "aho intomento" or "aho" is used. PC for personal computer is abbreviated as "pasokon." Chinese then are made clearer and more concise, though. In case of television, TV would be much simpler. Even worse is the combination of Western words with the Japanese words in abbreviations or acronyms, such as Dantotsu, abbreviated from Danzen Toku, for undoubtedly number one. We understand that the language is something dynamic and constantly changing with time and demography. And it is perhaps politically incorrect to force people to use only limited words. At the same time, however, it should be taught and used at least in schools or in public communications, including the mass media, what are the standards in our languages. This applies not only to our own mother tongues, but also to the following languages and technical terms for professionals. Practically, this is important to avoid confusion and misunderstanding, and therefore essential for professional communications. Culturally, it should help respect our ethnic, or you may call national, identities. Through learning the history of English language, I'm aware of the fact that there were systematic efforts in the 18th century and thereafter by the leaders of the United Kingdom to standardize the English language, including the word spellings, through the publication of dictionaries. Before such efforts, the same words were spelled in many different ways. Because the country, the UK, experienced waves of immigrants or invaders and changes in the rulers from different origins, Celts, Germanic tribes, Danes, Normans, and so on, who poured a whole variety of words from multiple sources into the English language, not to mention the influence of the Bible written in Latin or Greek. In modern days of global economy and rapid communication with multiple modalities, including satellite TVs and internet, it would be a wise practice for us all to keep accurate and standardized languages. For the Japanese language, the basic style consisted of Chinese characters interspersed with commas, should be the easiest and most comprehensible form. We might as well take the best efforts to refine our language in more systematic manners. To this end, the importance of Chinese characters in the Japanese language cannot be